Worthy to celebrate the exaltation of your glorious cross with sacred hymns and psalms. When you appear on the last day, and the sign of your cross will shine brighter than the sun, gather us before you and surround us with your eternal light, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father and to your Holy Spirit forever.
Amen.
Peace be with the church and her children. Raise glory, honor, and praise to the Savior who made the wood of his cross a strong fortress for his flock and established it as a sign of the covenant for the salvation of his inheritance. By his cross he exalted his church and gave joy to all people who believed in it. To the good one be glory and honor on this feast, and all the days of our lives and forever.
Amen.
O Christ our God, by your precious cross you have given us perfect salvation, and have made us worthy to celebrate this feast with hymns of praise proclaiming, blessed are you, O wood of the Holy Cross, for you erased Adam's curse and restored his banished children to their inheritance. Blessed are you, O Holy Cross, for you united heavenly and earthly beings. Blessed are you, O Holy Cross, for you have fulfilled the words of the prophets, enlightened the apostles in their preaching, crowned the martyrs for their faith, and have honored the confessors for their loyalty. Now, O Christ, our Savior, we ask you with the fragrance of this incense to make the celebration of the feast of the exaltation of your Holy Cross a sign of security and peace. By your cross, exalt your Holy Church, guide her shepherds, adorn her priests with virtue, purify her deacons, help the elderly, educate children, direct the youth, protect orphans, care for widows, and grant rest in your dwellings of light to our brothers and sisters who have died hoping in you. May we find refuge in the shadow of your holy cross on the great day of your second coming, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, to your Father, and to your Holy Spirit forever. That we have offered on the feast of the exaltation of your holy cross. May its sign always be visible before our eyes to strengthen us, that we may walk with you toward death, and then stand at your right hand to celebrate the feast of your eternal victory. We glorify you, your Father, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Kadishat, Aloho Kadishat, Hayelatono Kadishat,
Aloha, Kodisha, Hayatono, Kodisha. listen to your holy scriptures. To you be glory forever.
The sign of your cross, Lord, you ordain your holy priests, and they give us the mysteries through the power of your cross.
Reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy.
Glory to the Lord of Paul and the apostles. May the mercy of God descend upon the reader, the listeners, and upon this parish, and your children forever.
So, you, my child, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And what you heard from me through many witnesses, entrust to faithful people who will have the ability to teach others as well. Bear your share of hardship along with me, like a good soldier of Christ Jesus. To satisfy the one who recruited him, a soldier does not become entangled in the business of affairs of life. Similarly, an athlete cannot receive the winner's crown except by competing according to the rules. The hard-working farmer ought to have the first share of the crop. Reflect on what I'm saying, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, a descendant of David. Such is my gospel, for which I am suffering even to the point of chains like a criminal. But the word of God is not chained. Therefore, I bear with everything for the sake of those who are chosen, so that they may too obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus, together with eternal glory. Praise be to God always.
Alleluia. Alleluia.
The message about the cross is foolishness for those who are perishing, but for us who are being saved, it is the power of God.
Alleluia.
Good morning, the Holy Lamb, the glory and the honor of the Master.
For the proclamation of the gospel of our Savior, announcing life for our souls, we offer this incense and ask for your mercy, O Lord. Peace be with you. From the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Mark, who proclaim life to the world. Let us listen to the proclamation of life and salvation for our souls.
Remain silent, O listeners. The Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listen and be glorified.
The evangelist Mark writes, "Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to Jesus and they said to him, 'Teacher, we wish you to do for us whatever we ask of you.' And he replied, 'What is it that you wish me to do for you?' And they answered him, 'Grant that in your glory we may sit one at your right hand and the other at your left.' But Jesus said to them, 'You do not know for what you are asking. Can you drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized?' But they said to him, 'We can.' And Jesus said to them, 'The cup that I drink, you shall drink, and the baptism with which I am baptized, you shall be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to give, but it is for those for whom it has already been prepared.' And when the 10 heard these things, they became indignant at James and John. And Jesus summoned them all, and he said to them, 'You know that those who are recognized as rulers over the nations lord it over them, and their great ones make their authority felt over them. But it shall not be so among you. Rather, whoever wishes to be great among you shall be your servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you shall be the slave of all. For the Son of Man has not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many.'" This is the truth. Peace be with you. Rabboni, that I may see. In the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit, amen. The cross is a very sublime mystery, and very, we can also say, ethereal when it appears in our lives. And because of that fragility, we often neither see them nor appreciate them for what they are. Not appreciating them is certainly the case. I gave you a quotation at the beginning of this sermon of Rabboni, that I may see. It's actually further on in the Gospel of St. Mark today. It's in the same chapter 10 today. But it is the contrast. This is the response of Bartimai, the son of Timai, Bartimaeus. We read that Gospel during Lent. But he's the blind man outside of Jericho, that when he hears the crowds coming, he's begging outside the city. And he learns that this is why there's so many people. He realizes this is the rabbi coming. This is Jesus of Nazareth. And he begins to shout out, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And of course, our Lord calls him over and he asks him, "What do you want me to do for you?" And he says, "Rabboni, my master, my teacher, that I may see." It's a very beautiful thing because, and I wanted to bring it up because, as I always read this whole chapter 10 this week, but it's a contrast to James and John coming up. James and John, of course, the gospel that we have today, is they have come to our Lord and they first say to him, "We want you to do whatever we tell you to do for us," which is pretty offensive. Now, they butter it up a little. I mean, they have been taught to be polite by their parents. And so when they first come to him, they say, "Teacher, we'd like you to do whatever we tell you to do for us." Now, in another gospel, this same episode is being paralleled. And there it's even more striking, because there it's actually mom, a good Mediterranean mother defending her sons. Sons are very special in the Mediterranean. They are God. The daughters are nice, but better luck next time. Which actually was a quotation that was given to me by a poor woman in Fall River when she married late. She had one child, she had a daughter, and she was a lovely lady. I met her, she's an adult now. But she talked about when she went around the Maronite, the Lebanese community with her brand new little baby girl. All of the venerable old ladies were like, nice, may God bless you next time. So, James and John's mother is the one who comes to our Lord and says, I want you to make my sons your number one and number two on the right hand and on the left hand. But whatever be the case, it's the same story. And our Lord is trying to teach them to understand this subtlety of what this cross is. Because in this context, our Lord has just announced, we are going to Jerusalem. This is why later on they're passing through Jericho. They're on their movement to Jerusalem. And when we go to Jerusalem, the Son of Man, I am going to be betrayed, mocked, spit upon, crucified, put to death, and on the third day rise up. This is one of the times in which our Lord announces very, very clearly. And St. Mark says that he spoke to them openly. He tells them very clearly. This is not parables. He tells them exactly what's going to happen. And they understand none of it. They just know this is kingdom time. This is the time in which the Messiah, our Lord, and all their confusion about the Messiah comes forth in this. Because they only see the Messiah as being this conquering, triumphant hero. Which he is, but he's not only that. And that's why, even though they've just heard, we're going to be totally destroyed, they're like, oh, okay, so make us number one and number two, because they're actually not hearing. So the first thing that the cross actually does is it teaches us. None of us in our lives enjoy pain or disappointment or contradiction, or humiliation. None of us like these things. But our Lord says in this context, and has said in other places in the gospel, that the one who wants to be my disciple, the one who wishes to learn from me. That's why when we talked about the question of good translations, some of the translations will say, if you want to be my follower. Well, a follower in English means someone who's just behind you, just following you. To be a disciple is someone who is learning. Discere in Latin means to learn. Discipulus is just a Latin word. It means a learner. You want to learn from me, you have to take up your cross and carry it. Now, we know these terms. We know these. And we get so used to seeing the cross. We wear it around our neck. We have it hanging in our living room. We get so used to it, we forget about what it truly is. And hence, in the Eastern traditions, the exaltation of the cross is a whole season. And for the next 6 weeks, we will be considering the end of the world, which is why the icon banners that we have up, you have the quotation from the Creed. And he shall come again to judge the living and the dead, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. So you have the exaltation of the cross and our Lord in his glory coming as judge. 6 weeks for the end of the world. But before we initiate that crisis, that crisis, and as I've told you in English, that word crisis is actually just a Greek word, crisis. And crisis in Greek means judgment. That's all it means, judgment. So a crisis is a moment of judgment. How do you choose? What do you do? And the sad part of it often is, even when we try to be faithful following the gospel, and we talk about the cross, it becomes something of a cliche of just, well, offer it up, offer it up, offer it up, offer it up. And that's absolutely true, you should offer it up. But without understanding what the mystery of its subtlety is of the cross, then it becomes a lesson of how to be stoic. Grit your teeth, don't complain to me again, and offer it up. That is not the path that our Lord is teaching. He's not here to teach us to be Stoics. He's teaching us to be crucified, because in crucifixion is resurrection. It's why, in contrasting Bartimai and contrasting James and John, you see two things that take place here. One is, it's clearly just a deferential to butter him up, to call our Lord teacher. Now, they've already been following him. They've been with our Lord now, probably well over a year at this point. And they know they're getting close to whatever this glory is going to be in Jerusalem. And hence, they jump the gun on the others and ask to be number one and number two. After all, we were there, we're one of the first four, so hey. And because of that reason, we're told very explicitly by St. Mark, is that the other ten are very indignant. That they're trying to maneuver around. But that, anyone who's worked in an office, anyone who's gone to school, everyone knows this is what human nature is. We maneuver and manipulate. This is what we do. And the cross is precisely one of those first lessons that comes in that contradiction, in that disappointment, to shatter that illusion of being, by the effects of original sin, maneuvering and manipulative. So James and John, this is recorded not because it's a story about two men, but because it's a story which is very much the story of every man. All of us have these moments to butter up, to be deferential, to do all these things because we want something. But when the cross enters into our lives, it is actually there in order to bring us a teaching and to learn. It is why in the Syriac tradition, the cross is living. It is life-giving. It is victorious. And the Syriac fathers, when they write, the cross goes with our Lord into the tomb at his death. And on the morning of the resurrection, the cross rises with our Lord. It is identified with our Lord. And when our Lord says the sign of the Son of Man will appear and all the nations of the earth will see it on that day of judgment, he doesn't even need to say it's the cross. It is the sign, the emblem, the manifestation of the Son of Man, of the Christ. So the cross holds a very unique, that's why we will have this procession after the homily. We'll have this procession around, and you have the booklets in your pews for it. It is the exaltation of the cross, and then following that, there will be the blessing of the four corners of the universe, north, south, east, and west, with the cross that has dominion over all things to bring light and to bring life. And then normally in the ceremony, everyone comes up, and then there's a blessing of the holy water, and you're free to take the water after the Mass. But normally in the ceremony, everyone comes up and you bow profoundly at the waist and you kiss the feet of the cross. Well, because it's the apocalypse still, we'll pass that. But what we will do at the very end, at the closing of the, once the closing prayer is done, I will raise it up and all of you will bow from your, well, depending upon physical agility, you will bow profoundly in that adoration from the waist, receiving the benediction, and that will replace everyone coming up individually to venerate the cross alone. So there will be a bit of an adaptation, but we do all of this because this is life. This is the reality of what the cross is meant to be, of life-giving. And so while we will do always in the paradox of the gospel to be considering the end of the world for the next month and a half, it is because that is the final manifestation definitively of life. It is the moment in which the risen, glorious Messiah will appear, God himself in the flesh, to bring life to everyone and everything throughout the cosmos, transforming, as St. Peter says, everything by fire. That was yesterday's reading in the epistle. To transform all of the elements by fire. But that fire is also life. That fire is the giving of luminosity. So we learn in it. So it's very interesting when we contrast James and John. They come with a deferential title to our Lord of teacher. But you have the blind man, Bartimai, coming, and he uses the term Rabboni. Rabboni in the Hebrew, in the Aramaic, literally means my teacher. Not just teacher of tipping my hat, but my teacher. You are the one who brings me light and the one who can teach me in my blindness to see. And so the phrase is very beautiful. It's read during Lent because, of course, Lent is one of those moments in which we focus everything during those weeks that we may see, to know who we are. Rabboni, that I may see. It is a magnificent contrast between the two. But that aspect of the cross, which is not just gritting your teeth and offering it up, but to enter into the light to understand, what is it that Providence is teaching me now? Now, in our individual lives, of course, we have the virtue of prudence. And we are meant, using prudence and foresight and the intelligence God has given us, to avoid hardships in life to the degree that we can. But of course, a Catholic has always understood you cannot avoid all hardships. We live in a hysterical world today because people seem to think you could avoid every sign of pain and suffering and illness that is on the earth, which of course is kind of silly. Do avoid sickness. Do avoid poverty. Do avoid these things. But somehow to have the idea that the cross will be rooted out. If you remember 20 years ago, since we've all done the 9/11 thing, 20 years ago, remember, the president told us we were going to root evil out from the face of the earth. Oh, well, that's quite a mission. Considering that God himself in the flesh didn't do that, who are we? This is part of the ignorance of understanding behind the cross. This is why our Lord immediately says to James and John, you do not know for what you are out. You have no idea what you're asking for. And then he says, can you drink the cup that is mine? Will you participate on what I am truly here for? I've just told you the Son of Man is going to be betrayed, mocked, put to death. Are you ready for that? And of course, being these 20-somethings, you have to remember this whole conversation is between a man who is about 31, 32, and two guys who are probably 24. All right, so all of those of you who have gone past that age limit, everybody else would have gone, a bunch of young people, fine, and just gone on. What do they know? What are they talking about? They're too young. They haven't been beaten up for half a century. Then, you know, we learn a little bit as time goes on. And when we look back, those of us who have those bruises, which is every one of us, when we look back on those moments of crisis 20, 30, 40, 50, 60 years ago, and how agonizing those moments may have been, 9 times out of 10, and for those who carry wisdom, 10 times out of 10, we look at those moments and say, those are one of the greatest blessings in my life. It's a woman that I know, she has a handicapped child. When the child was born, she lost it quite literally. She felt guilt. She felt all of the sorrow that comes with this wounded and sick child, and eventually had to be institutionalized for a number of weeks. She told me about this story, because now she's in her 70s. But this handicapped child that she still has with her, she says, this has been my greatest blessing in life. This is a woman who has learned what the cross is. And she blesses that she has to, day in and day out, essentially 24 hours a day, take care of this child. And this child has made her a better woman, and she is a gloriously wonderful woman. But at the time, not understanding the cross, it made her have to be institutionalized in the hospital for weeks. She told me she had become insomniac. She's just taking care of all of her children, just running on automatic pilot. And realize this is not working. She's having a breakdown. And yet, now in her 70s, she knows this is her greatest blessing. And that is why our Lord says to James and John, do you understand what you're asking for? Can you be baptized with the baptism with which I have been baptized? Baptism in the Greek, baptizein, means to be plunged into something, into water. So our Lord is saying, in that in which I am being immersed, submerged, are you also going to enter with me into that immersion, that reality of mockery and betrayal and death? And of course, these two 20-somethings, what do? Well, like we all do in our 20s. We can, yep, sure, we can do that. Having really no idea what they're saying. And our Lord tells them, you will drink my chalice. You will be baptized with the baptism that is mine. St. James, between the two of them, James is going to be the first of the apostles martyred. He will be the first one to die of the 12. And John, John's going to be asked to live to an age of 100. He's going to live to the end of the century. And the Roman Empire will try to kill him at least two times, exile him once. You will be baptized with the baptism by which I am baptized. So they are, it's a magnificent lessons that are given here. And for us on this day of the Exaltation, it's for us to ask for that grace to see the cross for what it is, which is the embrace and the kiss of the hidden good one. The people who are not embraced with the cross, it's because, well, if you know the story of St. John Bosco, when he was building up his vocational school for all the young boys that were in the streets, all the homeless, these boys were just ruffians on the streets, and bringing them all together with his mother. And he'd come from a poor, simple, but you know, they ate, they had everything they needed in life, but a very simple life. But as money started rolling in, John Bosco became actually quite anxious. Because his thought was, am I receiving now, because I'm not going to receive anything after my death. The gospel is a complete contradiction to these get-rich televangelists. And John Bosco understood this. No one is pure evil. No one. Not even Hitler or Stalin, I'm sorry. No one is pure evil. And no one is pure goodness. Even the saints have their quirks and their faults. And for that reason, the God of all goodness rewards all goodness, regardless of who does it. Even Stalin and Hitler. But because he may know that in an individual's life, obviously God knows where we are 100 years from today, he will reward that goodness here below, because they will receive nothing of goodness after their death. And therefore, St. John, knowing this message of the gospel, understood that oftentimes prosperity and wealth in this world is a sign that that's the reward you're going to get. Remember our Lord said of the Pharisees, they have already received their reward. People recognize their goodness. And so John Bosco was actually quite frustrated. He was upset at first. Until through prayer and understanding of what he was doing for all of these orphans and all of these homeless kids, that in fact it was being used for the good. But that is not a normal reaction. We all pray to win the lottery, don't we? We all do these things. I would love to have a magnificent inheritance. Find that rich uncle that you never knew of who lived on the other side of the planet, and boom, here's your millions. We think like that because we think like the world. And that is why the Lord embraces us and gives us the cross, to smash those illusions. Not because he dislikes us, but on the contrary, because he loves us profoundly. And in those illusions, any more than any of you as good parents ever want your children to grow up in illusions and misunderstandings of life, so the Lord God also wants of those who desire to learn from him, Rabboni, my teacher, that we learn through this mystery of the cross. And so on this day, we may ask the Lord God that he expand our spirits to receive that light to see, so that when we ask of the hidden majesty for graces and things that we need in our lives, that they truly be enlightened as to the plan of God's providence. And that we also ask that, O Lord God, expand our souls and strengthen our wills, because how many crosses and blessings we have lost in our life because we are too weak, and we scream, and we wiggle, and we try to get out of. Because once providence has seen that this and that and this and that, that we have tried to get around, not have to go through, that when it's there and clear that I cannot change this, then the disciple of our Lord in his wisdom understands there is something to learn here. Not to scream about, not to complain about, and certainly not to pop pills about. But to learn that there is something of the majesty of light that is being given in this life-giving cross. And so we need the expansion of our wills to have that courage to embrace this majesty of what our Lord's teaching. Essentially, that rather than confronting God with a gazillion novenas to make him do what really has to be done, it should be rather the blind man outside of Jericho falling down before our Lord and saying, "My teacher, Rabboni, my teacher, may I see." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. So you can grab your booklets for the prayers that you have in the pews. We will psalm tone this first hymn. When the cross of light appeared, Constantine was filled with awe. He took heart and gained new strength, and he fought triumphantly. Now the faithful church, O Lord, looks upon your saving cross. May it be her strong defense in her fight with Satan's power.
Holy Church, honors and exalts your holy cross. Lift her head above all fears and worship on God's cross. The cross of life and the standard of our King, from the cross God's mercy.
May your salvation, God of more, O Lord, reach our church who believes in you and is glorified by your life-giving cross. By its side, may Christians be protected from all enemies, seen and unseen. We now implore your mercy and cry out three times.
Take my flesh as man, as the wind of life, the trouble, the rent, and the war.
Almighty Lord and God, you have accepted the offerings of our ancestors. Now accept these offerings that your children have brought to you out of their love for you and for your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life and your imperishable kingdom. As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we recall upon this offering all those who have pleased God from Adam to this day, especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, the Chosen One, our Holy Father, Saint Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint Januarius. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed, especially those for whom this sacrifice is offered, for the intentions of all the members of this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering. The greeting of peace with a holy kiss, that through Jesus Christ our Lord we may be a radiant and blameless flock. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace to you, O holy altar of God. Peace to the holy mysteries placed upon you. Peace to you, O minister of God. Peace to you, O server of the Holy Spirit.
Let us give the greeting of peace to our neighbor with love and faith, which is pleasing to God.
That you grant us in your mercy the riches of your grace and kindness. May your compassion and assistance sustain us all the days of our lives. Through the grace of your only Son and his love for all people, we glorify and honor you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever. Father, you sent your only Son to save us, for we are weak and poor. When we had gone astray, he brought us back to your spiritual fold by his royal blood. Through your grace and the favor of your only Son, we implore you to accept this bloodless sacrifice from our sinful hands, and through it to forgive our sins. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The love of God the Father, and the grace of the only begotten Son, and the communion and indwelling of the Holy Spirit, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Lift up our thoughts, our minds, and our hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord with reverence and worship him with humility.
It is right and just.
Truly glory, thanks, praise, and honor are yours, O God the Father, maker of all creation, with your only begotten Son and your living Holy Spirit. The angels, archangels, and all the heavenly hosts bless and praise you. They cry out and they proclaim. Whenever you observe these holy commandments, you proclaim my death and resurrection until I come again.
We remember your death, O Lord. We profess your resurrection. We await your second coming. We implore your mercy and compassion. We ask for the forgiveness of sins. May your mercy rest.
Lord Jesus Christ, you remember your plan of salvation for us, your conception, birth, and baptism, your saving passion, and life-giving death. your burial, your glorious resurrection and ascension into heaven, your sitting at the right hand of God the Father, and your royal second coming, when you will judge all people and reward them according to their deeds. Now we ask you, at that fearful hour, have compassion on us and have mercy on us in your kindness, and forgive our sins in your mercy. For this your church implores you, and through you and with you implores your Father, saying,
have mercy on us, Almighty Father, have mercy on us.
O Lord, as we, your sinful children, receive your graces, we thank you for them and because of them.
We praise you, we bless you, we adore you.
For the living Holy Spirit descends and rests upon this offering for our sanctification. Let us stand with reverence as we pray.
Annin Morio, Annin Morio, Annin Morio, Nite Mororocho Chayo Korisho, Unachenna Lainu Al Kurbono, Ono. May these holy mysteries be for the forgiveness of sins, the pardon of faults, the honor of building and strengthening of your holy church, and the protection of her children from all sin. And may these holy mysteries allow us to stand with confidence before your awesome throne, that we may raise glory to you, to your only Son, and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
O Lord, exalt your holy church established throughout the world. Protect your shepherds of the true faith in peace and security all the days of their lives, especially Francis, the Pope of Rome, the Shadow Peter, our Patriarch of Antioch, Gregory John, our Bishop, and all the bishops, pious priests, pure deacons, and all who serve your holy altar. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, all those who call upon your holy name. Bless those who are near, and bring back those who are far. Visit the sick, and strengthen the weak. Release captives and assist the oppressed. Bring back those who have strayed, that they may live in your fear, and reward those who have brought offerings to your holy church.
We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, our civil leaders and all the children of your holy church. Grant them security and peace, and keep domestic and foreign conflicts far from them, so that they may live in tranquility. Protect them by the sign of your living and victorious cross. Rescue the persecuted and displaced of your flock, and be a refuge for strangers and a companion to travelers. Grant your eternal reward to monks, to those who live solitary lives, and to hermits who live on mountaintops and in caves of the earth.
We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, upon this altar and upon your heavenly altar, the holy and ever Virgin Mary, Mother of God, the prophets, apostles, martyrs, confessors, and evangelists, John the Baptist, the forerunner, Stephen the Archdeacon and first martyr, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Juan Ignatius, and all the saints. May we join their ranks and share in their joyful feast. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the faithful teachers who have gone to their rest in the true faith, especially Peter, Paul, Mark, Clement, Ignatius, Dionysius, Julius, and all those who endured suffering and persecution for the strengthening of your holy church. Remember also those who serve your holy altar and forgive their sins, that they may reach your joyful dwellings. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, all those who have left this world and have gone to you. Lead them to your joyful dwellings and blot out all their sins. Through our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
Grant rest, O God, to the departed, and forgive the sins we have committed, with or without full knowledge.
Grant us pardon, O God, and forgive us and the departed, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us and in all things, with the name of our Lord Jesus Christ and of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, is now, and shall be forever.
You have sanctified this divine service and have perfected it in your good pleasure by the grace of your only Son and by the descent of your Holy Spirit. Sanctify us now, that we may be renewed as your spiritual children, so that with pure hearts and enlightened souls we may call upon you, O glorious Father and lover of all people, praying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Deliver us, O Lord, from every temptation of soul and body, and crush our enemy, the evil one. Grant us your mercy through Christ Jesus our Lord, for you are blessed and glorified with him and with your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, who gives life to those who partake of him, and receive the blessing from the Lord.
O Lord, look upon us, your inheritance who bow before you, and guide our steps on your right path. Make us worthy to share in this sacrifice, and may it sanctify the souls and bodies of those who receive it through Christ Jesus our Lord. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the most holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit, let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth. To him be glory forever.
Make us worthy, O Lord God,
so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy body, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins, and for the life. O Lord our God, to you be glory
forever. Amen. Again and again we thank you, O Lord, and praise glory to you for giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. O lover of all people, have mercy on us. God the Father, how can we who are unworthy thank you for your grace? For you have given us this divine gift and have made us worthy to share in the body and blood of your only begotten Son who saved us. Through him and with him, glory and honor are due to you and to your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you. Jesus Christ, our Lord and God, you are worshipped and you are holy. Bless and forgive the priests who are the stewards of your people and of your holy church. Forgive the servers of your divine mysteries and all the faithful who have shared in this sacrifice. Care for orphans, help widows, assist the poor and the distressed, satisfy the hungry, and protect all who call upon your holy name in every place. May your name be glorified with that of your Father and of your Holy Spirit, who is good, life-giving, and consubstantial with you, now and forever.
Amen.
So make sure you grab your flyers at the entranceways for next week's celebration on Saturday for the Hafli, the annual celebration of the parish, which will be in Winslow at the VFW. I meant to tell you all that it will be extraordinarily kid-friendly with zillions of games to play, and you will have outdoor dining, indoor dining, and if those don't work, you'll also have carryout available. So, grab your flyers, it's all there, and we look forward to seeing you with great joy next Saturday. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever. Amen. Amen.